So first off, I would like to say real quick that this is not, in fact, a magic show. So anyway, I, as he said, am Spencer Miller, and I love magic, like most other people. I love the idea of magic, I love the appearance of magic, and I think the majority of people in this crowd probably do too. Now, I'm talking specifically about the magic that we find in fiction, whether it be in books or TV shows, in movies. It's remarkable, and a lot of it is based on excellent world building. And this is where the creator builds a world for all the action to happen within, and it's the world that really interests us almost as much or possibly more than the story itself. Some good examples of this are the Harry Potter franchise. And almost as much as the story, the immense base of spells that all the characters inside of this series cast, and all the things that they're capable of, are extremely interesting. Additionally, Star Wars, it has the Force, something that we always enjoy learning more about in the next sequel, or, you know, I'll just say sequel, those will keep going on. They're not going to make more prequels. And Lord of the Rings, something where basically everything except for the people are magic. In fact, there's a lot of magical people too. So let's start off by trying that world building, trying to do that ourselves right here. So imagine this. Imagine a world composed purely of energy. All right? Now, as people emerge, they begin to use that energy for malevolent purposes. But as the knowledge of that energy increases, it finds as much everyday use. All right, as it provides power. And with the help of dedicated practitioners, the knowledge of this develops and continues going on. There are still questions of the balance of that energy, and there are still questions of how it works. It's still somewhat unknown. Well, from here you can build a good series. You know, I used some examples from series to show that. But the problem is we need to start over. This is a talk titled Real Magic, so that's not going to do. So we will start over. So imagine this. Imagine a world composed purely of energy. All right, got to point it. And as people emerge, they begin to use that energy for malevolent purposes. But as knowledge of that energy increases, it finds as much everyday use as it provides power. And as that knowledge develops with the aid of dedicated practitioners, it comes to be seen as a good force in the world. Now, there are still questions of the balance of that energy, and it's still somewhat unknown. You can probably see where I'm going with this now. This talk is called Real Magic because the scientists have taken a lot of the fun out of themselves. People have a hard time realizing nowadays that when they look at the world, it's deeper than Lord of the Rings, and it's more wondrous than Harry Potter. Now, the generations before mine, the generations not in high school, are going to have a little bit less trouble swallowing this because they've experienced a lot of innovations that are truly remarkable in their lifetime. And all of the movies that are around nowadays showing this weren't always around. So it's more magical. If you want to see an audience reacting with true wonder, go on YouTube and look up Steve Jobs introducing realistically usable Wi-Fi for the first time. The audience reaction is priceless. Now, we didn't always not have magic. In fact, a lot of the ideas of what magic is in fiction come from the history of the real world, things that we used to believe were real. For example, on the left, we have alchemy. Alchemy gets its day in the sun in fiction all the time, but people forget that alchemy was a real thing in the real world for a really, really long time. In fact, alchemists did a lot of things. Alchemists were credited with the European discovery of porcelain. There's a fun story there if you look it up. They're credited with finding metallic zinc, metallic arsenic, and they're also credited with the idea of artificially created pharmaceuticals. In fact, a lot of historians, such as Professor Principe at Johns Hopkins University, actually have concluded that chemists are the direct descendants of alchemists, that the first chemists were alchemists who decided to give up on transmutation and decided to remove their, at least, assumptions about the mysticism of science. And the same thing goes for physics. Before Newton had sense knocked into him by an apple, Aristotle ruled the day, and he said that everything moves according to where it should be, its proper place. Earth goes down, water goes down less, so it sits on top of the land. Air goes down, and it sits on top of the water. Fire's place was up in the sky, as you can see in the quote, and that's why the sun is up in the sky. And the problem is that this is a very intuitive approach. This makes sense. Additionally, Aristotle's idea that as you throw something and it's moving, it should slow down, that's intuitive. According to Newton's laws, when you throw something, it'll just keep going forever, but that doesn't really register with our brains that didn't evolve to understand that fact. And so that's what's so remarkable about the conversion to chemistry and physics, with the introduction of rigor, with the introduction of math. It's that they were able to overturn fundamentally held beliefs for hundreds and hundreds of years, like that. Now, we're going to see why we lost the magic of the world by looking at some fiction rather than the real world. So obviously this is from Harry Potter, and it's from the first movie. Now this scene really struck me because I really connected with it. I understood that magic was happening. It was like a key turning a lock in my head. And I invite you to think about the Harry Potter movies or books or really any type of fiction that dealt with magic and think about any moment that really connected with you, that made you think, wow, that's cool. And I'll give you a moment. So the question is, where did that go? Where did that inward grin, where did that amazement go in the last couple hundred years? Why are we not in awe of that remarkable machine? Why are we not in awe of that? That is as magical as anything you can find on TV. That's as magical as anything you can find in movies. So why are we not in awe? And I think that the answer comes in three parts, and they all stem from an example. Imagine having an octogenarian walk up to you, carrying that phone, and saying, wow, this is like magic compared to anything that I had in my childhood. Well, I don't think you would say anything aloud, but I think in your head, you'd tell her, well, it's not magic. It's everyday technology. Bill Gates could probably explain it to you if he wanted. And it's that sentence that actually contains the majority of why we lost that feeling of magic. And there are three parts. The first is that first word. It's everyday technology, every day. The fact is, we probably have just as many of these, maybe one or two fewer, in this room as we do people in this room. And the fact is, no matter how good a magic trick is, if you see it every day, day in and day out, it's going to get old and you're not going to see it like that anymore, even if you don't understand it. The second word that's very important in that on that front is technology. It's everyday technology. Now, Oxford Dictionary defines technology like that, as scientific knowledge that is used for practical purposes. Essentially, tested knowledge to do things. The trouble with this definition being for technology is that it applies just as well to that guy. He tests knowledge and then he uses it for practical purposes. In fact, in that movie, Doctor Strange, the Ancient One herself tells the protagonist that the only thing holding him back from believing in magic is the term magic. She proposes thinking about it as universal programming instead. All of a sudden, he understands, and the plot can advance. But more importantly, the audience understands and has a suspension of disbelief. It's technology, so we can work with it. And any system of magic with consistent rules can be thought of as technology like that, can be thought of as science. And likewise, any system of science can be thought of as magic with consistent rules. Now, the last part of that statement I would like to address is the idea that Bill Gates can explain your phone. And the fact is, he probably could. He's a smart guy, and he has the time to do it. The deal with that is that you can walk up to Bill Gates and you can ask him the questions. In fact, even the fact that you could do that is often enough for people to buy that something is not magic. If there is an explanation for it, good, we're done. But the problem is you can think about this in fictional terms too. Imagine you're Hermione Granger and you get the opportunity to ask Dumbledore whatever questions you want. So you ask him about this spell, and about that spell, and about that potion over there. And you ask him how everything works. Well, it's natural to expect there to be a common theme, a common reason why it all works. But with Dumbledore, you don't lose that feeling of magic. And so that opens a door. So from here, all that you really need to think about is the fact that Dumbledore can't do the things you do. Dumbledore can travel fast on a broom, but I bet you can travel faster in a plane. Dumbledore can communicate reliably, but you can do just that with your phone. And there's a bunch of computational things that you can do considerably better than him. So the fact is that we have magic, but we've just been dulled to it. So the question now comes to why this matters. And I think there's a man who knew an answer to this. His name was Arthur C. Clarke. He was a science fiction writer in the 20th century. Now, Arthur C. Clarke did a lot of things. He wrote the books that were the basis for 2001: A Space Odyssey. He developed the idea of geostationary orbit, and he discovered an underwater temple in Sri Lanka. Pretty diverse guy. But one of the most recognizable things that Arthur C. Clarke did is he came up with his three laws of science. And here they are. The first one deals with the fact that if there's a distinguished and elderly scientist and he says that something is possible, he's very likely right. That's reasonable. But if he says that something is impossible, almost reliably in the past, it has been shown that he's usually wrong. So the limits are usually further than we can see. The second law deals with these limits, how to find them. And the only way to find the limits of what is possible is to venture a little ways past them into the impossible. And the third law, you've probably heard this one before, is that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. That last one should ring a bell, and in fact, all three of these should ring a bell. Why? Because this is how kids, young kids, think about technology. They see it as magic. All of us have recognized these laws from as recently as each of our early childhoods. This is the way the world was. And that's what's important. Now, nerds stereotypically love two things. They love science, and they love fantasy. And the reason for that is because they both involve the same thing. Messing with the world, getting knowledge out of it, and then using that to do crazy things, like magic or science. And the fact is that it's going to be classes, labs, and experiences that are going to invoke these feelings of messing with things, gaining knowledge, and gaining new abilities that is going to allow these kids to fully reach that again, to see what they offer, the chance to look back to the ideas and beliefs and feelings of a millennium ago, of their early childhoods, and apply that to what they're doing now, to get that excitement back. In fact, that's something that we can all learn from, and that's why I love science, and that's why I think that anybody can too. It's magic.